swagger on the prowl. I'ma make it go wild. I'm original, and I told you so. I'm a kid in the candy store. Put the leather on the denim. I ain't the cure, I'm the venom. If you wanna find me, find the taillight. Something's coming in, you're gonna wanna take a red eye. It's time to go. It's time to go. Get ready. Get ready. Get ready. Don't blink, don't blink. Get ready. Get ready. Get ready. Don't blink, don't blink. I don't wait for nobody. I'ma sign my name on the dotty. City lights call my name, drawn to the flame, and I'm feeling kinda naughty. I hit the ground running, step out the door and I'm stunning. Better hold tight, cause you know what's going down. I'm setting the pace, cause this is my town. So get ready. Get ready. Get ready.
Good Wednesday to you all. Keely Dunn, FH Umpires here. Very nice to see you. I'll start off today. I'm just going to be super honest. If it looks like I'm squinting a lot, it's because I'm getting a migraine right now. I've taken my meds and I'm going to plow through it. It's going to be a bit of a shorter show probably than normal today, just because we're in a race against time, people. Like, there is a fetal position coming my way very soon. I'm going to be rolled up in a ball and I'm probably going to be crying. No, I'm just kidding. I won't be crying. I'll just be rolled up in a ball in a dark room with no sound and coping with it. It's one of those things. It's something that has started up for me in the last sort of 6-8 months. Thanks, perimenopause. And I'm learning what to do and what not to do. And right now, apparently I'm doing a lot of things I'm not supposed to do. So I'm glad you're here though. And it was really one of those things I thought, oh, I could cancel because, you know, but you guys always make me feel better. So I'm going to plow through and we are going to talk. So what are we doing today? I'm going to say hi to everybody, because I love doing that. And I noticed that Aline was here first. Rachel, I think, is umpiring. I have to say it because I'm so used to seeing Rachel, you know, naming the wine varietal that she's drinking and being the first here. And it's just so, I don't know, I feel a little empty inside right now because she wasn't here first. But Aline, I'm glad you're here. If anybody's going to take the crown, it should be you. Niels is here. Thank you very much for stopping in and helping out with moderating as always. Stain is here. That's awesome. Allie is here because she is now free on her Wednesdays during the day here in Canada because we're a lot behind. A lot of you. She's the most behind because she's Pacific Daylight Time. So here she is stopping in. Thanks, Allie. Good to see you. Amanda's here. Thank you so much. And Scott saying hi to everybody. Oh, you will be leaving promptly at 9 as you have training. Sebastian Archbold, thank you so much for recently joining up into the FHU 3T Green membership. And I don't know if you were around on the show that I actually did the, I mean, what? I could do it right now. I mean, why not? Nobody's the boss of me. I can throw confetti whenever I want. Sebastian, thanks for joining up. Your support means everything to me. So thank you. I'm very glad you're here. And let's see. Yes, good to see you, Godders. And it feels awkward for me to read that. I'm just trying to find a way to say that properly. But yes, very sad times over there in the UK and somewhat here. She really was a leader who touched the entire world, and not just the UK, not just the Commonwealth, but she did pave the way for a lot of female leaders, and we're going to miss her definitely in that respect. So Richard, good to see you. Northern Ireland. Whereabouts in Northern Ireland? I didn't get up there. I was able to go down. I did a tournament in Dublin 2006 and was able to travel around there. And look, I'm not going to lie. Like I love England. It's definitely, it's got that feeling of home. When I see movies that are set there, I was watching even Welcome to Wrexham this weekend, and that's set in Wales, but it's the cobblestone streets and the main streets and the pubs and everything. And I don't know what it is. I just get really choked up and I miss it. But there was something even deeper when I was in Ireland. There was something that just, it wasn't familiar, but it was known somewhere in here. And I loved it. I absolutely loved it there. And I love Irish accents so much. So anyway, hi. That's me on a tangent. I got a migraine. I can talk about whatever I want. There you go. Extraordinary scenes. This might have been the day of the funeral. You guys might need to catch me up. I've been prepping for a show, so my apologies. We have a holiday in Canada now, a federal holiday on Monday. There you go. Yeah, I hope so too. I've had five in the last week. So it's been a bit much. Mr. Pelmore, what is up? I'm glad you're here. Oh, I know, right? Oh, your wine comment was first, but it didn't make it on the live part because you were so early. Whew, it's a tough game you're playing here, Rachel, and I really appreciate how hard you play it. Awesome sauce. Hey, you're not bragging when it's not about you. You just were correcting me. And I appreciate that correction. There you go. The comments reset about 5 minutes ago. Yeah, it's an interesting thing, hey? There you go. And Combs here. Do I say that right when I say comb? Is that, do I pronounce the L more strongly? Comb? You're going to have to tell me if I nailed that one. I don't know. I've seen you for years, but just never even really said your name in my mind. In my broken mind right now. There you go. Taco. Good to have you. And there you are. You just missed the flag. That's all. Just missed the flag. It's all good. Oh, you saw it on the replay. Okay, good. Well, I got to celebrate you twice because you're that special. Just outside Belfast, the home of Ulster's oldest club, North Down. There you go. Ulster hockey. There are some really, I follow Ulster on Twitter and things like that. You have a great social media presence and I really enjoy keeping up with everything that you guys are doing. So thank you to whoever it is that is mostly responsible for all that. And I feel like I'm like, oh yeah, Ulster. I know everybody there. Very funny. Matt Sefton, good to have you. And Shane is kicking back with his morning coffee because it's very early down there in the Neeland, the Zealand of news. It was going to be funny if I said it right, but it wasn't. Okay. Oh, I know, right? Totally. It is very much like that. And I mean, Ryan Reynolds is Ryan Reynolds. There's nobody like him in the world with his manner of delivering humor and things like that. So yeah, I've been falling in love with that. And I even had an American friend who isn't into sportball whatsoever. Obviously, I'm not into sportball. I do not like the sport ball, but I like Ted Lasso and I like Canadian comedians who are very handsome. So Ryan Reynolds, you're in there. You're in there for me. But I had an American friend who said, yeah, I just watched the first episodes and I'm going to watch them again because I am falling in love with the people and the real life characters. The way that we fell in love with Ted Lasso and we didn't really, some of them were like, oh, I don't think I like you at all. And then you fell in love with them. Yeah. The folk of Wrexham are winning their way into lots of people's hearts. So that's really wonderful. Sorry. Squirrel. Do I have my, yeah.
Squirrel.
There you go. Don't miss Wales too much. It doesn't get as much sunshine as Calgary. That's correct. But right now I would really appreciate some overcast conditions. I would just nice, dark gray nighttime, maybe. Good. Oh, it is my, okay. So the federal holiday. Thank you. Okay. That all makes sense. There you go. Colm, that was the closest. Okay. You've been called worse off the pitch. Well, so have we all. The worst one that people call me is Yank. So, and to my American friends, I now apologize. There you go. A little catch up, Stefan, there. And there you go. We can settle for Collie. Collie? Okay, let me see how I feel about that one. I prefer nicknames that I give people, not that people give me their nicknames. So the other day, I hate to brag, but I don't need to brag at all. I was just exchanging an email with Brendan Creed, Brendan. And he signed off Creedy and I'm like, does that mean I have to call him that now? I don't know. I feel very awkward. So I've decided I'm going to find another nickname for him and just call him that and see how it goes. Why not? Okay. Let's have some music, shall we? Quietly in the background, very quietly in the background. And here are our topics today. There you go. We are going to do some mindset work, recovering on a mistake. We're going to talk over a question about carding on a penalty corner. More new season prep issues. That went fast. Okay, somebody's got to adjust the timing in Final Cut Pro a little bit better. That's me. And perhaps a bonus, if we get to it, to talk about Shirtgate even more. There you are. So just before we start, this show is brought to you by me and FH Umpires and the FH Youth 13. Don't forget, we have memberships. And if you're not a part of this and you're wondering, I don't know, Keely, I'm just not quite sure about her. Here's the good news. This is about the community. And so when you get into the Discord server and you start meeting all the amazing people that are hanging out, you're going to really see the power of what has been going on here. And I'd love to take all the credit, but frankly, it really is about how amazing all of the server members are. Now, it's free. Somebody mentioned this the other day. They were like, can I come into your private server? You have to pay, right? I'm like, no. The Discord server right here, fhumpires.com/Discord, it's free. You come in and you actually get a chance to interact with absolutely everybody. You can ask me questions in there. And it's my favorite place to do that because I know that if I answer there, then the people in the community who are invested in all of us together as an entity, I know that I can answer and share that knowledge with my favorite people. So, and it just helps me stay sane because when I was trying to answer everybody's questions by DM, it was nut bar. It was just, I was going crazy. So please do have a look at that. Come into the Discord, meet the team, meet your new friends. If you don't have any friends in there, you will very, very shortly. And then inside the Discord is where we do all the membership activities. So that's just the preview. That's just a little slice, but come on in, ask me any questions, ask the other folks any questions that you want, and we would love to meet you and hang out with you. Okay, let's see where, oh boy. Race against time, people. I wonder when my head's gonna explode. There you go. Call home what you both like. We are mature on this. Oh, call him is probably what you meant to say. Right, exactly. I'll give you all your own superhero names. I like that. That's good, Stefan. There you go. And thank you for the link. YouTube sometimes doesn't redirect those, but that's okay. There you are. And that is one of the many links for the Discord. Much appreciated. Okay, let's get started on our first topic. Mindset and recovering from a mistake. So this came into the server and I thought it was a fascinating question. I sat for a little bit and waited for other people to get their input in there, and you feel free to pop in there now and add your two cents after we've had a talk about it. This is a big wall of text and I don't expect you all to read it, but I wanted to show you that it was a wall of text. And Dawn, I hope you don't mind. I really appreciate the vulnerability you showed in this question, and I'd love to give you a really fulsome answer and an answer that I think is gonna help everybody in the audience about this and in the community. And it's essentially surrounds making a mistake on whether a ball hit a foot or not, on the far side of the goal, over on the end line. And so Dawn explains this in some detail and saying, you know, things were crowded, it was tough to see, and I was moving to try to find something. It was a weird sound that, you know, gave her a lot of reason to think that it had gone off a foot. Deadened sound, an extreme change of direction. She whistled for a PC, and everything in her instincts had said that it bounced off the defender's foot and there was no advantage to be had. And then all of the players, not just the team that had given up the PC, but all of the players had said, no, you're wrong. It wasn't. It was a hand. So, and this was a friendly, she added. So she was like, you know, if it wasn't friendly, probably nobody else would have fessed up to it, which is kind of sad. But, you know, we can talk about that in another issue. And so Dawn's question revolved around how to restart the play. What should she do? What would you do? WWKD, WWFHU3TD. Boy, I made that acronym really long. That's a hashtag for days there. But there was another section of this text that really caught my eye that I wanted to talk about first, before we get through all the rest of the answers. And maybe, you know, we'll see things in the comments as you guys start chiming in on this one. How would you handle this? What would you do? Please let me know what you think, because I've got lots of ideas. Oh, there you go. Oh, Dawn's here. I'm glad you're here. Okay. And you're off to training. Well, did I time that perfectly or what? Woo! That's me. Okay. And in here, Dawn said this, okay? But of course, try thinking of anything after you realize you've made a doozy error and you've lost the confidence of both teams. I was just trying not to hand them my whistle there and then. Ow. What would you do is the comment. So I'd love to hear from you guys. But I want to start with mindset, and I want to start with that section while you guys come up with some other answers and things like that. And I think we need to treat ourselves in our own heads and in the words that we say to others when we describe our experiences on the pitch, the way that we would treat our best umpiring friends, our third team members. Would you ever turn to one of your FHU3T people and say, that was a doozy error and you lost the confidence of both the teams? You would never say that. Because you know better. You know that an error is an error. It was just a mistake. It was early in the game. Dawn mentioned in another post, it was very early in the game. So nothing had happened yet. There's a lot of time in the game for you to make more mistakes. More mistakes that might be a lot more memorable than this one. So if that's the kind of language you wouldn't use with your colleague, with your friends who are umpires, why would you use it for yourself? Okay, so let's adjust that. And that might have been how you were feeling in the moment. But what we're doing here, the work that we're doing mentally, is to train ourselves to rewire our own thinking so that we don't treat ourselves like that. I feel like I'm off center. Okay, so we don't treat ourselves in a way that perpetuates our own negative and deconstructive self-talk. Okay, so the next time you're in this situation and you're looking for help and for guidance, it's okay to talk about how you felt. I'm not discounting that whatsoever. That I felt as though I wanted to crawl into a hole and die. That's totally fine. But think about, can you present this to yourself? And by presenting it to others in the way that you're presenting it to yourself, to say, I made a mistake. I made a mistake. That's it. And give yourself the grace of the of not punishing yourself overmuchly, putting too much emphasis on any one thing. Okay? And that way, I think it can help you with the feelings and the reactions that you had in the moment. So this is an ongoing work, ongoing process. Okay? Let's see what you all have to say in here. Right? And so one of the tips that I gave, Niels is saying here that he's made much worse mistakes, and boy, haven't we all. We all have made worse mistakes. And if you want to go back to the episode where I talked about that goal that was not called as a goal in the Loughborough game, and the umpires involved caught a lot of really completely unnecessary abuse and vitriol socially and were really taking themselves to task and dealing with the guilt and the shame and all those feelings and that sort of thing. You can go back to that episode. Niels, maybe you can search back to that. I think if you just go to the channel homepage and search Loughborough, you'll find it. We had a really, really good discussion about mistakes that we've made and the biggest mistakes that we've made and all of them and how we're all here the next day and everything is all right and how much we learned from those occasions and what they truly meant in the context of that game, that season, our careers, whatever the case might be. Okay, so doing this work, I feel, is really important in order for us to be able to get on that pathway to better performance, because we're going to give ourselves an opportunity to separate out that emotion, because emotion is really bad for thinking. And we got a lot of things to think about on the pitch. So let's make this as easy as possible to get to the decisions that we really want to be showing on the pitch. Oh, thank you, Michael. Have you said it before? Because I'm choking up because I don't think I've seen this before. He'll say it before. He said it before and says it again. FHE3T has been pivotal to his own development, making MPUA. Community is fantastic. And after the great games, the tricky games and everything in between. Oh. Okay, thank you. It's not taking away my migraine, but it's going to dislodge my eyelashes. So that's very good. Okay, there you go. Don't worry about it. Trust me, of the 99 problems I'm experiencing right now, your autocorrect spelling things are not even on the list. I'm glad you're here, David. There you go. And Luke has also slipped in the back door. Good to see you. Mike Mac, the other Mike Mac. My two favorite Mike Macs are in the house. For the restart, this is the time for me to pull out Keely's favorite thing that's not in the rule book, but should be the constrained hit. Nice. Okay. I love this. Okay, I think Rupert got this on the in the server and detailed this, and I really like this option as well. That when you have to restart play after nothing else has happened, as rule 6.5 dictates, you can award a bully. You should award a bully. Luckily, we don't have to worry about end of time situations in this, because if it was an end of time situation and a bully was called, you can't restart, or and nothing had happened. Hold that thought, my brain can't catch up. We'll circle back. Anyway, we don't have to worry about it, so why did I even bring it up? I don't know. But yes, calling the bully, and if necessary, instructing the players about the constrained hit. Okay, so saying to the defending team, as you're taking the bully 5 meters outside the circle, on the dotted line, some kind of parameter kind of lined up with where the incident happened. You're gonna have to kind of sort it out, whether it should be low or high or whatever on the circle. I don't know, does it really? Yeah. Okay, but somewhere that's sort of equally fair. And then to tell the defending team, and by the way, since the attackers, you know, had the ball and they were in the middle of an attack and I stopped them and didn't give them a result, can you just give them the ball? Just hit the ball back to them? That's the constrained hit that Mike Mack is talking about. So I think that's a really great option there. Paul, restart with the bully 5 meters away. Yep, from the D. And 15 meters away from the baseline, not 16, because that's one too many. Paul, if you're new. Ouch. Good to see you. I'm glad you're here. There you go. An agreement is had. And Mike Mack talking about errors, everybody makes them, including the players that are playing in the game. Yes. And the process for making the decision is what's important. Absolutely right. So restarting that play with the bully is absolutely a good thing. One extra step that you can add in, if you're a little unsure, you've stopped the play anyway, PCs or big moments in the game, this is actually a great time to go talk to your colleague, especially when your emotions are running a little high. So you could go to your colleague and say, I think I effed that one up. Am I right? And they'll say, yeah, it was a hand. Okay, cool. Super appreciate the help. What should I do again? Talk, use your colleague to talk that through. Okay, they're very helpful. They're very helpful that way. They're not gonna have that same emotional response because it wasn't them that blew the whistle. So they're gonna feel a lot more calmer, and being able to stop, reset yourself. So you've taken yourself out of that moment where you're in that not confrontation, but you're in that close contact with the players and they're asking you questions or they're saying, that wasn't a thing. You can separate yourself from that. Go to your colleague, safe space, good friend, talk it over, talk about how you have to buy the first drink at the bar afterwards. Okay, obviously it's a fine, so you know, pay up. I'm just kidding, only if you agree. And you've reset that moment and it gives you the chance to feel confident that you're making the right choice. Okay, so you can add that little step in there as well. Okay. Excellent. This leads me into my next point, Scott. Thank you so much. Scott saying he apologizes and uses an opportunity to show he's human and that he's listening to the teams when appropriate, and you pull some empathy out of them so it's a two-way street. Absolutely. Okay. So the way that you present this as a, you know, mistake has everything to do with how you're going to feel as well as how the players are going to feel going forward. Okay. And because I'm a wingnut and just, you know, I apparently joke nonstop now these days, the way I handle this would be to say, oh my God, I'm so relieved. It's my one mistake in the game and I got to do it early. Great. Out of the way. I'm going to be perfect from here on in. Obviously, I'm kidding. But to make a joke about my own perfection and mistakes, and to just so joyfully admit, and to paint it as a good thing, all within the parameter of humor, it works for me. Okay, it's one way I do that. You might just say, you know, hey gang, yeah, that's a great start. Not gonna happen again. Thank you, I really appreciate that. Tell the attacking team, hey, really appreciate you. You're helping me out with that one, right? That will really go a long way as well. So you've got some different ways of presenting it that will send the messages out to everyone and to yourself. Your body language, as you start making that joke, you're gonna relax yourself, you're gonna laugh, you're gonna smile. The smile itself will send the signals back to your brain that everything's okay. Nobody's died, everybody's fine. You can recover from this, and you are going to recover from this. Okay, yeah. Yeah, your gut feel is, yep, let's take a bully, says Rachel. Absolutely, and very common, right? We do this, if I don't correct myself once a game for a decision, I'm like, I think I need a little celebration here, right? It's okay to have those corrective moments. The key is moving to that correct decision afterwards. Let the players know that you accept it, says Godders, that it might be the wrong call, and it will actually do the opposite from what you feared, Dawn. It's not gonna have the players all losing their confidence in you. You're gonna gain their respect and their empathy right back, which is what Mike was touching on before. Luke, you've made a similar mistake and you found you're trying to turn into a laugh if possible helps to calm yourself. Yes, thank you, perfect. That's exactly it. Mike, thinking of it, if you will, like a striker has missed an open goal, you immediately sub yourself off, put the stick in the bag and go get an early shower. I only wish. No, of course not. There you go, Stain. Yep, you can't change the past, but you absolutely can change the future. Admit it, the players will appreciate and focus again. Love it. This is really nice to hear all these unanimous opinions on this. And Taco, one tip from a pro referee, think I make about 10 mistakes a match, 9 more to go. Yeah, and that's kind of like the more honest way of saying what I do in the beginning, which is, all right, I'm done. Job done. I came out here to ruin this game. Already done in the first 6 minutes. Yes! No, I'm just kidding. I wouldn't. Would I go so far as to say that? I might, in the right context. There you go. Luis Ardolo Cardona Domingo. Hola from de Guatemala. Great to see you! Oh my gosh! My first audience member, my first community member from Guatemala. It's so good to have you. I'm glad you're here. Path for the win. Let's go. Sorry. Vámonos. Thank you. And I hope that we can get to know each other. Come into the Discord and tell me about yourself and how long you've been umpiring and stuff, okay? FHumpires.com/Discord. That's awesome. I don't know. It could be. Somebody click on it and find out. What is the search and critique again? Loughborough. I'm pretty sure Loughborough was all in the title. Maybe not in the title, but the description. Anyway, we'll find it. Yep. Better to embrace those mistakes. Absolutely. Jenny, you smile and buy yourself time to consult the supporting umpire. Yep. If it's a big decision, perfect. And if there's a disagreement, if it's outside the D, you try to laugh. But it's really hard then. Free hit or bully, depending on, yes. Let's see what the rest of her, there it is. You've beaten yourself up 1,000 times, sleepless nights. Yep. And that's something that we all feel, right? We all want to have that perfect game. We all want to give the players our best, because we know if we do our best, then that means that they get to play their best. That commitment to performance is exactly why we're so gratified, why we get so much enjoyment, not like barrel of monkeys fun, but enjoyment out of umpiring, is because we know the impact positively that we're having on the game. So make sure you keep thinking about, and it kind of gets back to what I talked about last week with, I can't remember who it was. It'll come to me in a moment, but we talked about dealing with, in some mindset stuff, dealing with taking too much or overemphasizing negative feedback after the game, that you're focusing on negative things. And the tip that I gave there was to pull out, like, just pull out a napkin or a journal or something like that, your phone. And after every game, make it a habit of writing down three things that you did really well in that game. And I think at the time I said you can talk about things that you want to improve on. Hey, if you're really trying to change your mindset with this, fuck the improvement parts. Oops. The improvement parts. Just give yourself those three things. Train your brain to look for and acknowledge and study and internalize the good stuff and help shake you out of that pattern. So there you go. Let's see. I think I skipped somebody here. Somewhere here. Stain, as for the restart, bully, speak to the team. Yep. And remind them who it was, and they will sort it out and do the proper bully. Love it. There you go. Kathy York. Hi. It's been a hot minute. You would thank the teams for their honesty. Yep. And hopefully that brings them on board. It is hard. It absolutely is hard. But everything is about how you then make your next decision and the next decision, the next decision. So if you've given yourself the feedback of the laughter, the relaxation, the reset with your colleague, whatever works best for you, that grateful acknowledgement to a player on the attacking team, hey, I really thank you so much for that. That was really sports person-like. I really, really appreciate that. And suddenly the focus is on not how you're feeling about it, but on the goodness of what just happened out there. And again, you're interrupting your own brain patterns. We're trying to rewire everything here. So I love that. Yep. Bottom line, each match, Jenny says, we get better, but getting input from others helps. Yeah. Thank you so much. Oh yes, Jenny is a green team member. So in the Discord. Yep. And this is all about confidence and support. You bet. Aline, you thank the players. Yep. And try to get over it quickly. Yep. And restart 50 meters away from the baseline and 5 meters outside the circle. Yep. That's very good. Mike.
Drop.
That's a hell of a way to retire, is to miss a penalty stroke and then just walk off the field. I'm done. That's it. Never picking up this stick again. Just kidding. Wow, you guys are very talkative today. Thank you, because it's really helping me get through this. Anytime when the benefiting team declines, you thank them. Yep. And often with a little discussion of the captains. Yeah, it's good to get to touch base with the captains. That's a very good thing. And Hockey Moments is here live. Yes. There you go. I'm realizing I have a lot more sound effect buttons, and I'm like, I should be using those a lot more often. I'm in that day. There you go. There you go. I don't know what's happening here, but I don't know. There's Niels and Stefan are having trouble writing something. Who knows? Oh, Loughborough. Okay. How do you not know it's spelled Loughborough? That is the worst thing I've ever done. I literally said, yeah, perfect. Okay, Niels found it. That's really good. But I can't believe that I did the English thing and said a very difficult to pronounce English word that does not phonetically make sense at all. It's like Cheshire or Worcester sauce. I did it. I'm sorry. My dad is going to be so mad at me. He's like, you're Canadian. Speak like Canadian. I can't help it. Your held thought. Pretty sure you're okay. Toward the building then end time because you're not ending existing PC. Thanks, Mike. I thought so too, but I just thought, you know what? I'm just going to give up. I'm just going to... because it's tricky. Sorry, there was no need to press that button. Yes, Steve Godders, for development, look, focus on overall performance, not on individual decisions. Yes, and this is something that I know Godders does a lot of work on, and all the rest of you who are doing umpire coaching, mentoring in the group as well, think about what you can learn from that and whether there are any trends that you can pick out from an umpire's performance there. So when we're doing a watch party, for example, and I might point out that is a management turning point of the game. It's not so that I can go back or, you know, in a hypothetical world and go to that umpire and say, remember at 15:27 when, you know, you gave a verbal warning instead of the green card that was probably the better decision, and then everything went absolutely ape. This isn't working. My mute swear button is not working. It's not to pinpoint the mistake. It's about understanding why certain mistakes might happen, so that you can take the corrective action, you can change the habit, you can recover better, which is something that we're definitely talking about here. So there you go. If you get a good vibe from the players from how you responded, you can move on quickly. Yep, absolutely. Thank you for that. Rachel, of course, there's a time in a friendly tournament that Andy Poulin gave you a green card for missing several things. Oh, that's good. Was it a blue card? Did you have to go have a drink? That seems fair. It's about Lugerberger. Beruger. Luger Beruger. Chris. Yes, right? Does that even... It doesn't make sense. It's like pneumonia or anything like that. Worcester. Yeah, Worcester. Yeah, there you go. Have we met?
Squirrel!
Okay, look, we're just getting through today. We are just...
Squirrel!
Getting through today. There you go. It is a massive squirrel. Okay. So, I hope we covered all of that really, really thoroughly. Thank you everybody who chimed in the comments. And, you know, we were all on the same page and I really like that. And that's something that is a supporting colleague. So let's pretend we are all Dawn's supporting colleague here. If we have radios, what kind of strategies could you use to help your colleague recover from something like that? Because we've seen it happen. We've seen our colleague get themselves into a wee spot of bother. A spot of bother. And is there something we can do to make that better? Can we help them with a joke? Can we gently, you know, get their attention to help them get to the right decision? You see, I'm not saying words like interrupt them and correct them and things like that, okay? Are there ways you can do that? Are there things that you can say as a supporting umpire to the other players around you and say, you know, hey, don't worry about it. We're in this together. We'll get it sorted out. You know, thanks for helping. You know, you can help sell all that rapport building as well. So you have a role in this as well. That's perfect. Did Andy give you the, yeah. Oh, it was just a warning. It was just a warning at the time. Rachel didn't have to go sit on the 2-minute suspension chair. Just got that warning. Okay, fantastic stuff. Thank you so much. Let's move on to our next topic. Did anybody notice I have new splash screens? Did you notice this? Carding at a penalty corner. Let's talk about this hot little nugget. Okay. This came up in our huddle on Monday. So the FHU3T. Have you met the FHU3 team? Our yellow group huddles every Monday currently, and we talk over what's happened on the weekend and any questions we have and some get some strategy tips from each other and some support and commiserations and all that stuff. And the question arose from Mr. Paul Harriman that had been posed to him, and he wanted some confirmation. If you've given a penalty corner for whatever it might be, and then you've given a player a card for dissent, can that player be replaced on the end line to defend that penalty corner? Answers on your napkins, please, in the comments. I'd like to hear all of that. Yeah, Niels, I really don't like the naughty chair stuff. And I know it's cute, but given that this is a in more intense competitive games, this is a big moment. It's a management point where a player has to be removed from the pitch in order to properly reset their conduct and reset the game in terms of scales of justice, because they're down a player now for the 2 minutes or the 5 minutes or whatever the case might be. And it's a little condescending. And that might not come across for somebody who isn't a native English speaker, but it sure sounds condescending to me. So I don't like using the term at all, because if we can take out those judgmental, insulting elements from the management interventions that we're taking, it might make our jobs easier on the pitch. So I don't like it when announcers say it, especially in important international matches. It's like, really, the naughty step? Really? It's the frickin' Olympics and you're calling it a naughty step? It's the gold medal game and they're going to sit on the naughty step? Come on. Anyway, sorry. I just had to get that out. And this is what we can do, is I can pose you a question, and I can go ahead and talk about something else in the past, and then by the time I'm back, the YouTube comments will have all cut up. So there you go. Let's see. First thought, you can still defend with the full number and fewer on the halfway. Okay, thanks, Rachel. Stain depends on whether the carded player had already set up to defend the PC. Interesting. Chris, is the situation after a reaward may or may not make a difference, you guess? And now I can use the... It's tricky. Depends on what stage we are in the penalty corner, and a subsequent one, no, before the first one, yes. That's okay, Stefan. There's context to everything. You don't have to apologize for calling it a naughty step, because that's where Bailey's at. It's totally fine. Yes, it was a mini rant. I gotta save up the main rant for later. Okay. Yeah, why not? I like that. I like that, Niels. Why not? And that's a really good way of approaching all of these kind of questions in the rule book. Because if something, foreshadowing alert, if something is not explicitly ruled as being illegal or against the rules or a foul in the rule book, then it should be assumed to be okay. That is how the rules are structured. It doesn't give you a set of actions that you are allowed to do, unless it specifically says goalkeepers are permitted to do these sort of things, blah, blah, blah. Really what it's doing is saying, these are the things that you're not allowed to do. And umpires are gonna award fouls for them. Okay. On the question, if the card is dissent, the team chooses who defends, then yes, they can. An example from your own match, player got sent down to the halfway line, his teammate swears, the ump gave a red card, don't know if they got replaced. That's a very interesting, very real world example. Okay. Now, Luke was in discussion, so I'm seeing his comment and I'm going to read it first, because if he totally, you know, guesses the answer, then I need to know. Okay. So let's go with Luke here. You're not cheating, Luke. It's okay. You've explained it very, very well. So in answer to this question, the only penalty that removes a player from the defending of a PC is the one that says the player broke the end line early. There is no reason why a carded player can't be replaced by another legal player, I think is what you meant to say, Luke. Cannot. Excellent work. Okay. And this is the reasoning here. Okay. The only rule that takes a player that cannot be replaced off the end line is the early breaking defender on a penalty corner, 13.6 sub C. Okay. Explicit language that says the offending player is also required to, crosses the back line, is they're required to go to the beyond the center line. It cannot be replaced by another defender, and the penalty corner is taken again. Okay. Otherwise, the play can be defended with a full complement of defenders. Okay. It doesn't matter if it's the first penalty corner or the second penalty corner or the third. Okay. I would think that if, first of all, in a management situation, if you're carding players for a misconduct, for something that isn't pertaining to a foul that disadvantages the opposition, okay, that you've got some other things to deal with in that moment, okay? But if it's one of those defenders who is beaking off at you, you can send them and they can come back, just as Luke says here, because the timing of when a player, or was it, it might have been somebody else. I can't find it now. Because up until the point that the penalty corner must proceed because you've decided that it's time for it to proceed, or it's been 40 seconds if you're umpiring at that level, up until that point, they can change their people around as much as they want. So who's to say that that player who's dissenting is dissenting at you and they're near the end line, but maybe they weren't going to be defending. They just happened to be in that area. They just happened to walk that way because that's where you are. And they wanted to get right in your face. Okay, so that there's nothing in there whatsoever. Yes, the team can defend the pit and corner with 4 plus the goalkeeper anytime except they break the line rule. Absolutely, thank you very much. Niels, love this. Grabbing the rule book right now. Okay, we're gonna get back to this in the third segment, but can I just blow an air horn for that one? Because that's how good it is. You're out of space in your comment. Yeah. Oh, that's really weird. Scott, the one thing you're sure of, that any change or swap must not delay the taking of the PC, even if the swap is allowed. Yeah, kind of. I mean, there can't be like inordinate delay, but you're not going to sit there and say, if you don't get somebody back from the center line right away, you can't defend with the full five, the complement of 5 players. You're not doing that. That's a bit of a compound that is a little over and above, a little bit on that excessive side. Okay. Here we go. Ben, what if the defense starts with 3, one breaks early and gets sent, can they still have 3? What do y'all think? Was that a very long pause? I should have just drunk my tea in that moment. I'd like to hear your thoughts on that one. I'm gonna star this. Okay, and Scott, you've come across this when a card has expired during a PC. Okay, not quite sure where that was. It's not hard today, Ben. The migraines got me on the ropes and you just gave me that uppercut that just snapped my head back, gave me a concussion. Yes, and as you said before, why not stain? Absolutely right. If a player breaks, then they have to stay with three for subsequent rewards, says Chris Palmore. You think yes, because the rule is up to five defenders. I like this. We're having a debate. But, counters Chris, if they start with that many, then can them up to it to as many as they want to, you guess. It's an interesting thought because a team may decide, I don't know, we've got Shrijesh in that. We don't need five defenders. We don't even need four defenders. We're gonna go with three. And then are they able to, if a defender breaks early? I think what we have here is a classic loophole situation. Because unless you're playing indoor, it's very, I've never seen a team, I will declare this right now, I have never seen a team intentionally defend a penalty corner with fewer than the maximum number of players they were allowed. Because it is so disadvantageous. Indoor is a bit of a different story. I don't know if this is something that you've ever seen as an umpire or if you've played indoor, if this is a thing, but I would do this on my teams often when we've got a good penalty corner unit. We'd have our six, you know, lined up. And I'd be like, yeah, it's kind of crowded here. Why don't you go high? Because we're going to get this ball and we're going to wing it up the boards. Off we go. Okay.
Squirrel.
The answer is squirrel. Says that. Okay. Let's see. Yeah, you have an outdoor? Ben. Ben, come here. Just kidding. I'd never resort to violence. I'd just shame you with my glare. That's dumb. Ah, that's why I use the word intentionally, Ben. They may have been confused, but they started with the goalkeeper and three defenders. That's different. They didn't intend to. It's not a strategic decision. There you go. The danger is that early line break reduces the number of defenders to one, the goalkeeper, or zero. If the goalkeeper broke early, they have no defenders left. We don't even want to think that. Mike, make a firm decision, sell it. All the players go, okay, we play on, it gets discussed in the bar after the game. I like it. It's a blue card situation. We don't have a definitive answer. To me, it makes sense on both sides. Because if you're allowed to bring back a different defender in order to make up the complement of maximum allowed players, what you'll notice is in the rules, okay, the way that the wording works is that they can't be replaced by another defender. It doesn't talk about absolute numbers anywhere. And you can argue that if you've started with fewer defenders, you are replacing that defender anyway. And that shouldn't be allowed. I'm going to call it right now. And I'm going to give the air horn and the mic drop to Chris Pelmore, because I think he's right. So, if you see what I did there, thought about it for a bit, I went and read the rule again, and then I applied the principle. What is the rule trying to achieve? A cost to the defending team for breaking up that penalty corner opportunity, forcing the attackers to redo something that is a highly tuned, you know, close timing, strategic decision incident that they have to now repeat in the middle of their flow. There needs to be a cost to that. And the cost is that you defend with one fewer player. Yeah. Read the rule. Have a think. Read the rule. Think about the principle and then apply it to that situation. I am going to follow up on this though. Thank you very much for bringing this up and breaking my brain, Ben. You're just good on you. That's from before. So just because the player can't and someone fills the gap, that's not replacing them to the up to five. I see that point of view as well. I see that point of view. That on the flip side, technically, they're not being replaced. They're just changing, but they're able to make a decision about how they're going to defend and change the way they're going to defend after the penalty corner has been set. So it's kind of like the equivalent of them starting with four and then saying, oh, no, JK. You know, it's time to go. The umpire said, blown the whistle to start the penalty corner. And they're like, JK, we're gonna go with five. Okay, it's that sort of equivalency. It's not the strongest argument I've ever made. Let's say that. Let's see. Yeah, I'm not gonna touch this one because as you can see, I'm already broken. So this conversation about players coming back on after cards have expired when it's during the penalty corner. Okay, this, I'm gonna leave that. It's also perhaps an England hockey regulation issue. And that's why it's important for umpires to also know regulations in their playing areas, because that could vary the practice of what is going to be played in your particular area. Okay. Did I answer all that question? Did that all work? I think I did. I think we got there. I think we got there. That was good. That was good. Good times. Good times. Okay. I am shocked. I thought this was going to be a quick one. Is it me? Do I just talk too much? Am I not able to restrain myself? I was sure this was going to be like a 40-minute episode. I'm like, this is all I've got. This is all the energy I have. And here we are at 108. We might not even get into the rant of the week bonus. Are you going to be sad? Topic three. Let's go. More on new season prep. So I thought about this over the past week because we had a brief conversation about it. And I thought, you know what? I kind of did a crappy job of it. I really, like my debrief, when I debrief my own What Up Wednesday episodes, I watch them back as I'm using this tool called Descript, which allows me to develop a transcript automatically from the audio analysis. But I have to go through and I have to correct things. Like, I have to make sure that Stefan's name is spelled with two F's and not one. And I have to make sure all the penalty corners aren't Pony or Poloni costers. And, like, some of the terms are always wrong. So I have to go through and make corrections. And in that sense, I debrief myself and I review my own performance. And I was watching back that section and I was like, you know what? That's just not good enough. And it's a question that comes up very often. It comes up pretty much at the beginning of every season for several umpires. And Steve was the one in the server who brought it up last week, that he's like, oh, I got an umpire next week. What does everybody do to prepare and get ready for the new season? What is the preseason and things like that? And he said reading rules is on his list. So I'd like to hear from you guys. I have four ideas, but I'd love to hear what kind of things that you're thinking about. what you're thinking about. And while that's going on, okay, while that's going on, I'm just gonna hop back to this screen so that I can wrap up some things from the last one. Let's see. Hubris, we're defending with three players. Fail. Okay, we're actually bringing our other defenders back and we're defending with four now. Exactly, right? Seems a little unfair. Chris, we'll take it to the Discord, set up the scenario, and I can maple leaf the correct one. You need another maple leaf? Is that what you're angling for, is another maple leaf? Mike, the counter question, can replace the other three defenders if one breaks early? Yes. Oh my god.
Squirrel! Squirrel! Squirrel!
Mike? Okay, let's take that one into the Discord for sure. That's a really great question. Screen shot. Actually, let me make this a lot bigger. And then oh wow, that is so much more readable. Why have I never expanded that window before? Oh my goodness, Keely Dunn, you are a Muppet. That's some negative self-talk. Keely, you made a mistake. And you forgot. Okay, so I'm screenshotting this question because it's too good. It's too good to ignore, and yet too much for my little brain to handle right now. David, good news. We got one coming up. There you go. Well, no, I'm not checking your spelling. I'm checking descript spelling of your name because I feel like I should get it right. If I'm gonna publish subtitles, I want your name to be correct. It really struggles with Niels's name too. Okay, let's get back to it. Niels, you're prepped for the new season. Reading the rules, checking the umpiring uniform, charge the exceeds, and check the umpiring bag. Yes, really good items. Many there for you. Ben just wings it, but Ben, this is why you are slowly being assimilated into the third team. There you go. And you do the radios the day. Yes. I mean, we have to charge up our radios before, you know, the day before every match just to make sure it's there. And you're hashing out your season's personal development plan. I like this a lot. Why don't I have that on my list? Good work. Let's talk about this more. I'd like to hear about your personal development plan. Godders checks the kit, checks the new rules and interpretations, fitness, and warm-up games. Warm-up games. Yeah, that's a good one. I like that. Go and watch a decent standard game with umpires you ideally know. Call the game in your head, chat to them afterwards, make a note of big decisions, gets your brain fully plugged in safety. I like that. You little... Very funny. Luke, part of your prep, get out there and umpire. Teams need practice games. They need help with practice games, need the umpires. and there's more understanding if things go wrong. A lot of things do go wrong, but it'll be fun. Yes, practice games are absolutely there. Stain checks the news season's briefing in addition to reading the rules, absolutely. And Niels will rewatch the FHU third team shorts list 1,000 times. Oh my God, that's a winner.
Can't hang with the big dog, stay on the porch, blow the whistle.
No, there you go. You binge the Ruly Tuesdays, says Ben Burton. Now that you know, check that you know where everything is. Okay, go for a runner few. Watch umpires briefings. FIH and Scotland hockey. These are really good like this. And yes, so do I. I wish we could too. There you go. So Niels, I think, is posting the links right now or has done in the chat for a couple shorts that I did on checking your umpiring kit. So these were the ones that I sort of pulled out, mostly because, I mean, all of these things are fairly common sense, and I really appreciate you guys adding some more to the list. Maybe I'll amend this on the fly as we go, but yes, the number one thing is review the rules, and I mean read the rule book. Now, there's this feeling inside the community sometimes, a bit of that rebel streak that we all like to have. We might say, I don't need to read the rules. I am 50 years old and I don't need to read the rules because I've read these rules so many times. What could I possibly learn? And the thing that I've learned as I've gotten older is that although I have learned much and I've spent much time in the rule book, I've also forgotten a lot of things. And you can make assumptions in your head, just like your memories. We are psychologically geared, evolutionarily trained to alter our memories in order to fit what makes us feel better about ourselves. Okay, our memories are terrible about incidents, and we tend to just shave a couple details, not because we're jerks, but because it helps us deal with an incident and continue on the next day. It's kind of nice that we have this psychological self-defense mechanism. I'm not mad at it. But you can also do that with rules too and convince yourself that, oh, I heard this and I like that person. So yeah, that's what the rule says. And you literally alter your memory. You're like, yeah, I've read that somewhere. No, you haven't. And the only way you can know for sure is to actually read that rule. So reading the right rule book is very helpful. Absolutely. As I'm reading comments and not putting them up on the screen, that is really, really important. So this is something that I would do on the plane when I went to every international tournament. So I've at least read the rule book 30 times. A lot more often than that. Okay. The other way I want you to think about this is that reading the rule book isn't just like a one-time thing that you do. And learning about the rules isn't just like something that you do and now you don't have to work on it anymore. It is a lifelong process. And despite the fact it's not a living, breathing document, the way that we interpret these things, the way that we apply what we've seen to the rule book is shifting all the time. But we need to be anchored in what is actually written on the pages. So one other way you can do that as you're going through the season is to seek out, or when you participate in conversations, like, I don't know, say you're on the Discord server. Did you know we have a Discord server? And somebody asks a question about rule or something to be applied. Your first instinct, I do this all the time, might be, I'm gonna spit it out. I know what that is, bang. 13.3C, I got this. We talked about it earlier, that's why it's fresh in my mind. Take this opportunity to say, you know what? I'm going to double check. Open up the rule book. Do a search. If you've got the PDF, friends, you've all got the PDF of the current rule book on your computers, right? And synced to your phones. Because yes, there is the rules app, but it's sometimes not reliable. So don't rely on it. Sometimes it's not updated with the latest stuff. You got the PDF. There's this amazing thing. Hang on. There's this amazing thing in the top corner. Am I going to be able to show it? Let's see if I do this. Unlock. And I'm going to do. Let's see. I'm trying to show you. There it is. There it is, friends. Oh my gosh. What is that in the top corner? It's a search bar. And you can search for terms like leg guards. And this actually helps you not only just go to the rule that you're thinking of to review it, but maybe will catch you up on some other places that pertain to that issue or that element of play and pull it up to your attention. So, oh, sorry, that's really, really small. What? Oh. Knowing what you're dragging and pulling on is an important thing. So anyway, this is another one of the many reasons why I'm such an absolute about using the right words. Why you have to say meters and not yards. Why you have to say penalty corner, not short corner. Because if you do a search for short corner in the PDF, you ain't gonna find anything. How can I help you? How can you search? How can you find the information you need? Oh, you did it! Oh, Ben Burton. Ben Burton. Oh my God. And search for shuffles. Oh, see, you know, you guys already know what I'm gonna say before I say it. I love that. And there's, yes, Command F for all us Mac people. I love that. There you go. You just have to program it in on something like a Stream Deck. So it's all there. There, okay. Okay. So y'all are sorting out your penalty corner thing. That's cool. Maybe we'll talk about it another way. And we'll do that. Yeah. To make you read the rules and updates against the Stefan, you do a Kahului quiz. I've never heard of that. For your teams that you coach to help you all. Now you're being asked, and also now being asked questions by parents. You like to note if you need to read again. Absolutely. And like, take the opportunity. Learning the rules is an open book study opportunity. Everywhere except when you're umpiring the game. We have $1,000 supercomputers in our pockets that can show us the rules anytime we want. There's literally no excuse. And you don't have to memorize like clauses and full language and you know, rule numbers and things like that. You don't have to do all that, but because that might get way too nerdy for you, and I understand that, but this is just super, super valuable. So if you're answering questions from parents, like Stefan is, if you are chatting with your friends in the clubhouse, and all the players are gonna ask you, because you're the umpire, and they're gonna ask you, what is up with the aerial rule? And you'll say, okay, let me tell you about it. Actually, let me just, okay. So have you guys ever read the rule book? Hey, have you read the rule book? Have you met my friend, the rule book? And you can use that as an opportunity as well, okay? In all of those contexts. When you're in, Niels is gonna kill me, the Discord server. Great time. Take the opportunity. How many times have people said, I'm pretty sure it says that somewhere. And I'll be like, nope. You might luck out, but why not feel confident and sure before you post that answer? Just saying. Okay, Do. It is me. It is me. I'm taking too long. It's true. Prep the body. Okay. We all know that probably the best time to start your physical preparation was 6 weeks ago. Or 3 months ago. Or to not have an off season. I get it. Okay. But now that we've gotten that guilt out of the way, the best time to start is now. And it's an opportunity for you. If you're feeling fresh and new and you're all excited by the new season, it's a chance for you to establish new habits. And this is what we started talking about last week when we talked about, you know, writing in the journal and making that a habit to write your three good things that you did in a journal, on a napkin, in lipstick on the bathroom mirror, whatever. I'm not judging. But little physical habits can help set up compounding gains for you that you start at the beginning of the season and they compound so that by the time you're at the end of the season, you are getting closer to your physical peak than you've ever been. And when it's a habit, it's something that you don't stop doing over the off season, the sportball season, the other sportball season, whatever it is that you're doing when you're not doing hockey. What does that mean? I don't know. You all do hockey all year. I've just declared it. Okay. So those new habits could be something like, if you're going to sit down and you're going to watch House of Dragons, you have to sit down with your roller and you got to roll out your calves and your IT bands during the first 10 minutes of the episode. Okay. That's what some people call habit pairing. So you take something that is gruesomely painful. Okay. Maybe that's just me. Something that you really dislike doing or is something that you're trying to get over an obstacle in doing with something that you super love to do. That is really easy, that's pleasant. You, in effect, are rewarding yourself for doing the bad thing. You're like, okay, if I'm gonna watch House of Dragons, I gotta roll. But yes, feel that reward. I'm getting that positive reinforcement right away. And you're also really cleverly convincing your brain that actually good things happen when I'm rolling. Yeah, okay, there's still some pain, but I feel good. I feel relaxed. I feel interested. I feel, you know, whatever it is. Okay. It's really a sly way of tricking your own brain. I think I mentioned last week, I know I did, that I've started walking every day. And it's not that walking is unpleasant, but it was something that I had to set aside time and say, okay, I need to get this done every day. I'm putting it aside so I can just like get up first thing in the morning, go to the computer and start working. And actually I know that when I start walking for longer than 30 minutes, I start getting into some pain. So there is a mental barrier there for me. So what I paired my walks with were listening to podcasts. So I listen to business and sometimes hockey podcasts. Let's Stick Together, Brendan Creed and Phil Roper and Joop de Mol's podcast. You should go listen to it. It's really, really good. Don't watch it. Listen to it. You're going to watch it soon because they're going to live stream it. Watch. It's going to happen. I love listening to podcasts and I love learning and it's a priority for me. But I didn't have a lot of opportunities to do it because I don't commute. I work from home. So going out for the walk gave me the chance to do this thing that I really enjoy doing. I love that self-improvement. And then I paired it with something that I needed to do that was a little bit painful. And now, oh my God, I look forward to my walks every morning. When I go to sleep at night, I'm like, I get to go for my walk tomorrow. What am I going to listen to? Is it going to be Ali Abdaal? Is it going to be Jared Spinks? Is it going to be, you know, and I'd go through the list like, oh, am I going to listen to Fame Lady Squad from the blockchain? Like, what am I going to listen to today? So habit pairing can be a way that you can add some physical preparation elements, into your practice. Okay. You're correct. There is no such thing as a pushback. Oh, David, you have a question. Can you use your smartphone on the pitch to look up something if you have the rule book on your smartphone? No. Obviously, first of all, you'd have an iPhone. And then next, kidding. If you have enough time to go to your bag, pull out your phone, because you should never, I'm sorry, I don't care if you're timing your match with that, do not have your phone with you when you are on the pitch. Yeah, let's do it. No phones on the pitch. End of story. It sends the message that you are not there, that you have other things to pay attention to that are more important than this spectacle of athletic excellence that you are facilitating, okay? Never take your phone on the pitch. Now, if you can go, I mean, yes, but really, that's the moment in which you need to give your best answer in the closed book exam, explain it to the players as best you can, present it, sell it, and move on. And if you need to get corrected at the bar afterwards because you've pulled out your phone, or the minute the game's over, you go running over and you look and you go, oh crap, it was supposed to be another PC and not a bully because it was an end of time and it was, C'est la vie. Center pass doesn't have the same ring though. I don't know. Start saying it. See how it rings. 5 meters didn't sound very comfortable to me 25 years ago when they changed the rules, but I managed. And now, anytime somebody says the Y word, I throw a tantrum. Mike, are you drunk tonight? Because you're hilarious and out of control. Indeed, I'll absolutely explode. But the players don't have to push or play the ball backwards. Exactly. They could hit it. They could aerial it. They could scoop it. They could self-pass it. It is a center, whatever, pass. Kahoot, yes. So Stefan, I do know this program, K-A-H-O-O-T, kahoot.it. Very cool. Fat fingers again. Okay. Michael McCartney, many parents of junior hockey players consider them the guardians of the alternate rules of hockey, trademarked. Lives have been lost trying to explain out of certain situations. It's not easy. It's not easy, but I found actually having the rules with you when you have a conversation and politely, with grace, saying, you know what, this is what I read the rules to say. Do you want to take a look at them with me? Let's do this together. Can be a nice way to get it done. Okay. David, don't listen to anything that Mike Mack says. Nothing. He is a liar and a thief. Just kidding. You're a great guy. Yeah. Umpires love it when you start an on-pitch discussion with, I have the rule book right here on my phone. Yeah, there you go. Thank you for coming. Kakidiano. If I say it really fast, does it sound better? There you go. I will take full credit for the success of the Let's Stick Together live stream version of the podcast. There you go. Yes, you inspired me. Seeing other people doing their thing and doing it regular and going, dang, they're committed. And I watched you when you got all your K's all lined up and you were setting records and all that kind of thing. And I'm like, if Rachel can do it, so can I. It's never a bully, the Pibworth rule. There you go. I mean, yeah, it's not that it's not allowed. It's just really not good practice. Kind of like wearing shorts and no socks. It's just not to be done. watch the hockey. Okay. So this could also be do the practice games. But if you can't get out because it's truly preseason and there's nobody out there on the pitch that you can do practice games for, is to watch the hockey. One thing that could shake this up for you is don't just watch the same kind of hockey that you've been watching. If you go on YouTube, you can find all kinds of matches from all over the world. The RFVH put up their top levels of full matches. The German Bundesliga, the Dutch Luftklasse. There's tons of matches coming out of Australia. Some of them are on watch.hockey. They're carrying some of the league down there that you can find those broadcasts. Watch hockey from an area with that people have strange accents and kind of approach the game a little bit differently. Different skills, different pace, different structures, different systems. Shake things up in your brain so that you have to ask yourself questions. And do as what was suggested earlier is umpire the game along with that. And you will, you know, reap some pretty amazing mental rewards in keeping yourself sharp. This is why we do the watch parties in FHU3T Yellow, is so that you are being exposed to hockey that you're not umpiring. You're umpiring with it. You're seeing some best practices. You're also seeing things that need to be improved on. We're having discussions about it. We're asking questions. We're finding alternate solutions. Whole nine yards. FH Umpire Strava group. Can you do Strava on Apple Watch for games in preseason? Absolutely. So if you haven't been in the Discord server, did you know we have a Discord server? We have this running joke that we call the left corner challenge. Is that what we call it? Ben, do we call it the left corner challenge? Well, people will put up their Strava running pathways and they'll prove to everybody that they have not run around the corner flag, because I'm trying to shift everybody's movement patterns from out there to inside the pitch. So the more lines that you have inside the pitch and staying as far away from that left corner flag as possible, the happier I am. I'm doing my Gary V thing. So get in there and post your left corner challenge photos, because I love that. Watch hockey from a place with people from strange accents. You could do that too, but you should probably, the hockey people will have the strange accents. And wait, did I? Okay, so this is probably the slogan that you want, Luke. It's never a bully. The Pibworth rule. We just need a shirt that says the Pibworth rule, and it will be the deepest inside joke ever. And I love that journey. Let's do it. Yes. Yes, you do this all the time. Listening to me and the way that I talk, I do this intentionally, okay? Like, I'm not just out here in these streets acting like a Nimrod and saying weird slang and occasionally swearing or frequently swearing at you because it's not just because it's the way I am. It is authentic. It is actually who I am. I am all of those things. But I am giving you pattern interrupts. I'm giving you different keywords. I'm giving you different facial expressions, different emotions, different everything, trying to shake the tree so that you get exposed to the same things that you've been told for 5, 10, 20, godders, how many years now, in a different way. So it might click your thinking. It might help you think about a concept in a different way, explain it to somebody else differently, implement it on the pitch differently. There's all a master plan involved. Makes me sound very clever. The no corner challenge. Yes, okay, the no corner challenge. That's the one. Okay, let's do that. It's a running joke because you're the ones running. Strava's on Apple? Oh, okay. Can somebody put that link in Discord for me so I don't have to search it for myself? Thank you. Okay. Bye, Godders, good to see you. That's my cue that I've been taking too long. Review the bag. Okay. As Niels alluded to a few times and put up the links, getting into your umpiring kit before the season starts is a really good idea. Check if you have a hole in your socks or perhaps in your umpiring pants. Did you lose your green card last season? How many times have people like lost their most frequently used card and then have needed to borrow a green card from somebody else before they've stepped on the pitch? How many? I'm sure, like, just put it in the comments. I want to hear it. Mike, that's why players aren't allowed in the Discord. I'm just kidding. Players are totally allowed in the Discord, but our jokes are ours. Okay, we get to have our own culture. We are building something here, and we don't have to pander to anybody else's things. We could call it the No Flag Challenge, maybe? I don't know. Argue about it in the Discord. Tell me what you decide. Okay, so review the bag. Let's see. Something that you might want to add, as we've been talking about, you might want to put a notebook in there. And this leads me to a question that I wanted to know. Yeah, I can't do it now, so just throw it in the comments. Would you be interested, all of you, gang, would it be helpful for your development, your personal development plan, Chris Palmore, to have a physical umpiring journal that is laid out with the prompts, the things that you need to record after your matches, on a season basis, maybe milestones, not necessarily goals, because you know I don't like goals, but milestones, track your habits and things like that. Would that be something that you all would be interested in if it was like super dope? Like, just assume that it's gonna be dope. Would you find that helpful, useful? Let me know. Let's see. There you go. Almost Achilles 70 minutes now. You're right. It's been Achilles. It's been past Achilles hour. It's Achilles match. I don't like to say my name that often. It makes me feel icky. Okay. And what were the other ones that people had? Okay. I'm gonna watch this. Watch this. Oh. I'm gonna put review the briefings underneath the category of review the rules. Practice the matches. Okay, that's another one. There you go. You do not have the Apple Watch Ultra. Do you? Did you order it? Are you going to order it? Can we talk about this? Can you please come in the Discord server and tell me about this? I looked at it and I'm like, that's outrageous. That will measure all the things. That watch will measure all the things that I am not doing in my life. Because there's no kayaking setting. I don't scuba. I don't adventure run. I don't run marathons. I don't swim. I mean, it's all the things. But I did order myself a Series 8. It did happen.
Squirrel!
Sorry, this is a 6, so I've been holding out. But I'm like, yeah. Oh, I almost forgot. Okay, lots of good prep ideas. Trying to sum that up so I can get to the bonus part, because Mike needs something to drink too, and I promised about that. Ben! Can we be best friends and talk about this a lot more? This is very exciting. Ben is doing a dissertation on umpiring performance. I'm very excited about this. Let's talk, okay? Let's see. Sticky, S3, Strava. Strava for the watch is horribly inaccurate. Okay. Oh, very good. You run Strava, Sticky, and Samson Health. One of them will pass the no card challenge. Cheater. Okay. Chris Palmore mentioned it in Kit on the Discord. They're in your basket online, but you're not buying until you have better options. Okay, right. Oh, I'm removing that from the broadcast because let's get to our bonus. Bonus, the shirt gate double down. We have the explosion and don't have the graphics. You little, and see, watch, it's gonna turn on there. And then it's. Sometimes Ecamm. Sometimes. No, I'm ranting without glasses. So we talked about this last week. We talked about this issue that has arisen because at the outset of planning, the EHO committee omitted ensuring that there was a female fit equivalent of the male fit umpiring shirt available at the outset of this season. Okay. I have not only in the weeks prior, but over in the past week, have been exposed to even more emails and even more dissertations on the topic of what are the correct facts of this situation. As I said last week, can I please repeat for everybody's understanding and full clarity? I don't give a whose fault this is. It's my fault. Does that help you? Does that help if I say I did it? I'm the one who made the decision. Does that help? Because what's happening now is that everybody's wasting their time still arguing about who didn't speak up, who wasn't at what meetings, who did which, who did. But there's women on the committee and they didn't speak up and blah, 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 blah. And if Keely's gonna go on live, she needs to get her facts straight. My facts are this. There is an offering for umpiring shirts from England Hockey that are not available in a women's cut, and that is wrong. It sends the message that women are not important to the umpiring community within that national association. Those are the only facts you need to know about. Nobody's calling anybody. Some people are calling people names, okay? I'm not calling anybody any names. Until we get to something like this, this was the email that came out from the EHO with a couple of very lovely individuals who happen to be female umpires modeling the new umpiring shirt. And now I'm angry because this, my friends, is what we call gaslighting. Oh, you think that it's unacceptable that there's no women's fit shirts? Let's show you how wrong you are, and we're gonna put these shirts on a couple of female umpires and show you how good they look. You don't have a right to complain. Gaslight this, bitches. Okay? All you have to do, as I said last week, is make it right. Admit the mistake, admit the admission, and make it right. And what makes it right is not going ahead and selling the men's shirts and saying, well, there's not really a lot of women umpiring anyway. There's been very little uptake, so we don't care. Like, I'm just getting more and more angry as we talk about this. I understand that there could be an entire district, region, sorry if I'm saying the wrong terminology, who have collectively decided that they aren't going to order any men's shirts until the women's shirts are available. I'm not here telling anybody what to do. I am not the boss of you. This is your association. This is your umpiring practice. These are your peers. These are your colleagues. These are your teammates. It is your decision as to how you are going to handle it. if I have inspired you in some way, if I have helped you feel the anger and the resentment, and if it wasn't enough, going back, you can go back last week and you can look at all the really shitty pictures. Pictures that I'm actually really, like, kind of ashamed of me umpiring in ill-fitting shirts. Go back to that and watch it again, because you might as well make my shame full bore so you can really understand how it feels. If this concept is unfamiliar, is foreign, is whatever, talk to some of your female friends. Talk to your mom. Talk to your daughters. Talk to your female colleagues out on the pitch. Ask them how they feel. And ask them what they think. And what should be done now. Now that the mistake has been made, what needs to be done now? And that, my friends, is my rant of the week. No gaslighting. Thank you. Rachel doesn't care whose fault it is. Scott doesn't care whose fault it is. Luke doesn't care whose fault it is. Hang on. Luke doesn't care. I'm trying to get on that. Luke's on the mead. There you go. Taco, get in the server and get on the No Corner Challenge. We'll talk about it more. Taco, you were at my, were you in the positioning workshop? I can't remember. There you go. Gas. I don't even know what that meant in the moment. I was just so angry. I also would like to have some volunteers who would like to design some cool shirts, and I will put them in the shop right now. Just design a shirt. Give me a nice big, you know, an SVG file would be ideal, or a really big PNG, and I'll put them in the shop. Okay? Because we need to capitalize on these inside jokes. Oh my God. There you go. Okay. It's coming back. Don't you worry. It's coming back. We're doing another positioning workshop soon. Okay. As soon as I can get this migraine thing under control. All right. There's just nothing more to say about that issue. Fix it. Please. All right. This has been the longest short show I've ever done. I had a really good time. And again, I can't thank you guys enough, because you come here every week and you give up your time and you engage with me. You lift me up, you correct me when I'm wrong, you help me out, you make really, really funny jokes. Thank you for that. And even when I'm not having a great day, you make it great. So thank you for being here. I am looking forward to hearing everything that's going on in your new seasons. Let's start a conversation in the server about PDPs or whatever you want to call them. Let's talk about journals. Let's talk about shirts. Let's talk about many more things. FHumpires.com/Discord, just in case you didn't know. And I look forward to seeing you all in there. Thank you so much, and bye for now.